Thank you so much, John, and the rest of the organizing committee for having me. It's a pleasure to be here. And today I will present early results from this ongoing project, Family Spillover Effects of Misdiagnosis, the Case of ADHD. And this is joint work with Sinyal Kui, who is a PhD student in economics at Stanford, and with Maya Rosen-Slater, who is at Stanford School of Medicine. So a central challenge in healthcare is understanding who needs medical treatment. So if you break your leg, then you know that you need medical care, but many diseases are imperfectly observed by individuals themselves. So this makes screening very important. Now we could of course screen everyone, but in practice, universal screening is often infeasible. And this makes whom to screen a critical question. So intuitively, if screening resources are scarce, we want to make sure that we zoom in on high-risk individuals when we allocate those scarce screening resources. And there are different ways to find or tag individuals who are likely higher risk. One common approach is to use an individual's own characteristics, like age, for example. So we allocate mammogram screenings, so cancer screenings for women, from age 40, for example. Now, in this paper, we're going to study another mechanism for allocating scarce screening resources that is not based on an individual's own characteristics, but that is based primarily on links to other people. Now, in particular, we're going to focus on family ties. So allocation of screening for conditions with a hereditary component is often based on the presence of a family history of the disease. And again, cancer, for example, breast cancer is a good example. Now, the benefit of this is obvious, and that's why we do it. So precisely because these conditions are hereditary, using family ties can help us to zoom in on or accurately identify higher risk individuals. But what we'll emphasize is that when the disease diagnosis process contains errors or is noisy, then there may also be important costs of using family ties. Okay? Now we already know from an important literature that misdiagnoses are costly, they raise healthcare costs, and they adversely affect the people themselves that are erroneously diagnosed. Now, what we will do in this paper is to add to that by saying that tagging of family members may also spread misdiagnosis in the family tree and thereby amplify the costs of misdiagnosis. And we're going to study this particular question in a particular setting where misdiagnoses are prevalent, namely mental health care for ADHD. So ADHD is the most prevalent health condition among children, both in the United States and in Sweden, which will be our empirical context. So in the US, 9.4% of all children aged 2 to 17 had an ADHD diagnosis in 2016. Now, importantly, for our purpose, ADHD is also a condition that is widely used as an example of a condition that is commonly misdiagnosed. Now, this graph illustrates why. It shows you the share of children who are treated for ADHD in Sweden by the child's own month of birth. And the vertical line here in the middle shows you the school cutoff in Sweden. So children who are born in December are youngest in their classrooms. And among them, we see that more than 5% of all children are treated for ADHD. Children who are born just a month later in January are oldest in their respective classrooms. And among them, the share treated is more than 20% lower, so less than 4%. Now here, we use data from Sweden, But let me emphasize that this particular fact has been shown in many contexts, including the United States and Canada. And a common interpretation is that young children appear immature relative to their peers in the classroom, and this gets quote unquote mistaken for ADHD. Now we can look at the data and see if there are any systematic differences between December-born and January-born children or their families before school age. And we don't find any such systematic differences. So this suggests that the gap that we just saw is consistent with one or several of the following. So first, there may be overdiagnoses of December-born children. So that means extra false positives on the left in the graph that we saw. And or underdiagnoses of January-born children. So extra false negatives among children who are oldest in the classroom. So they may appear too mature. And it may also be the case that there's overdiagnosis of all children, but more so among December-born, or underdiagnosis of all children, but less so among December-born. Okay, so there are many interpretations here of this gap, and the literature tends to emphasize the first one, so overdiagnoses of December-born children. Now, in this research project, we do not need to take a stance on this. So what we note is that under all of these interpretations, two things hold. So the first one is that December-born children with quote-unquote lighter symptoms are going to be diagnosed on the margin. And second, under all of these three interpretations, the gap that we observe stems from differential rates of false diagnoses, positive or negative, on the two sides of the cutoff. So we are simply going to refer to this as a misdiagnosis gap. And then we're going to ask two questions. So first, does this relative age-induced misdiagnosis gap spill over to other members of the family? And through what mechanisms? And second, if so, how do such spillovers affect the long-run economic well-being of the recipients of these spillovers? We ask this and think this is important because a positive diagnosis typically leads to long-term use of ADHD prescription drugs. So 50% of all individuals who initiate ADHD drugs remain on them 5 years later. And this is a statistic from Sweden, so from our context. And the long-run effects of the use of ADHD drugs are not yet well understood, but we will see that the results from our analysis of younger siblings' earnings suggest possible adverse impacts on long-run economic well-being among individuals that are treated on the margin. Now, in order to ask the research question that we want to ask or to answer these questions, we need to overcome several empirical challenges. And the central one is that we need data that allows us to observe which children consume ADHD drugs and that allows us to link those children and to their family members and that allows us to link to data that tracks future economic outcomes. Okay? And we're going to overcome this empirical challenge by leveraging Swedish administrative data. And we're going to use three linked data sources. So first, we're going to use healthcare records for the entire Swedish population. And in light of the topic of this conference, if we take a step back and pause for a moment and think of the United States, then it's hard to imagine how this type of data could be assembled, at least at the moment, given that how the health insurance market is highly fragmented. Now, for better or for worse, in Sweden, everyone has the same public pharmaceutical plan. And so this allows us to see drugs for everyone. Okay? And we're going to observe detailed pharmaceutical claims for more than a decade, so from 2005 to 2017, where we observe each individual's prescription drug purchases in pharmacies. And here we see the exact date of these purchases, and we see the exact ATC code. So this is a classification code that allows us to identify ADHD drugs. So we see which individuals consume ADHD drugs. We also have outpatient specialist and inpatient claims that we match to this data. And these contain exact diagnosis codes, so we can identify ADHD diagnoses. Now we link this to a population-wide panel of tax records and educational attainment, which allows us to trace the longer-run economic well-being of the individuals that we study. And then, of course, our third source is very important for our purpose. It's data that allows us to connect individuals to their family members. So we have everyone in the data, but we also need to know if we have a guy called John, who is John's sibling, okay? And we're gonna form an analysis sample by taking all individuals born from 1990 to 1996 who have at least one younger sibling, or in some specifications, who have at least one younger cousin. Now, one quick slide on the institutional setting here. So in Sweden, children must be seen by a psychiatrist in order to be diagnosed and prescribed drugs treating ADHD. Now, schools play a key role in referring children to a psychiatrist for evaluation in Sweden. So Sweden has a universal school healthcare system. So on top of the universal health insurance system for everyone, there's also a universal school healthcare system where all pupils do annual well visits. And national guidelines require that the age 10 annual well visit include a mental health screening. So these are light mental health screenings. It's not a rigorous ADHD evaluation, but this is a point where there's a natural point where schools can refer children on for a full ADHD screening. Now, another important fact here is that schools often have direct economic incentives to detect ADHD in their students. Why is this? It is because school financing rules often offer extra transfers for students with special needs. So the goal of our empirical design is going to be to analyze how relative age-induced diagnosis of ADHD among older children affects their younger children. Affects their younger siblings, okay? And in some specifications, how this affects their younger cousins. To do this, we exploit the discontinuity in the older child's likelihood of ADHD due to the school age cutoff. And we will also always allow for a discontinuity with respect to the younger child's own relative age as well. So the first terms in this regression equation, highlighted in purple, are what we would include if we would use a standard RD design to study the impact of the older sibling's month of birth on the older sibling's own outcomes, okay? Now to study the spillover effect, so that's these variables up here, and then to study the spillover effect on younger siblings, we will keep these purple right-hand side variables. So our main coefficient of interest will be beta 1 here, and it will capture the sibling spillover effect. But we also add the same right-hand side variables, highlighted in green here, defined with respect to the younger child's own month of birth, to allow for a discontinuity with respect to the younger child's own relative age as well. The identifying assumption here is that only the treatment variable, which in our case is the older sibling's relative age for grade, is changing discontinuously at the cutoff. All other potentially relevant variables are smooth functions of the month of birth. And we examine the distribution of births, so a standard McCrary test. We also use birth records data, so additional data, to examine gestation length, the idea being that a discontinuity in January would imply that parents may manipulate the timing of birth. And in addition, we also look for discontinuities in family background characteristics, like the average birth spacing, the gender composition of the older and younger siblings, parental education levels. And finally, we look for discontinuities in the younger siblings' predicted ADHD drug take-up. And these analyses do not reveal any systematic discontinuities at the school entry cutoff. Now, this graph presents graphical evidence. This is basically the same graph as we saw earlier, but we now instead plot the ADHD treatment of younger siblings against their older siblings' month of birth. And we see that children with an older sibling who is youngest for grade are substantially more likely to use ADHD drugs than children with an older sibling who is oldest for grade. So how large are these spillover effects? Well, this table shows the regression estimates, and the outcome here in columns 1 and 2 is an indicator equal to 1 if the younger sibling ever has an outpatient claim with an ADHD diagnosis. And the subsequent columns capture take-up of ADHD drugs. And we also report results both for our main analysis sample and for a sample restricted to siblings who are close in age. Now, highlighted in blue here is the estimated spillover effect in our main sample. And when we compare this to the sample mean, we estimate that younger siblings of children who are born after the cutoff are 12% less likely to have an ADHD diagnosis than younger siblings of children who are born right before the cutoff. Now, is this spillover effect large or is it small? One way to benchmark this is to compare the spillover effect to the effect of the younger sibling, him or herself, being youngest for grade. And this is the estimate in the second row of the table. So if we do this comparison in column 1, the spillover effect is 35.5% of the effect of the younger sibling, him or herself, being oldest for grade. So before we proceed to long-run economic costs, let's just take a moment to think about potential mechanisms that are driving these direct spillovers. So we just saw that the ADHD misdiagnosis gap spills over to younger siblings. So to think about the mechanism, let's just pause for a moment, take a step back, and think this through. So the etiology of ADHD has a genetic component. So this means that a true positive diagnosis of one child actually is informative of the younger sibling's risk for ADHD. So we might want to actually tag younger siblings when we have a true positive diagnosis. However, a false positive diagnosis is not informative of the younger sibling's risk for ADHD. Nevertheless, we observe that younger siblings of marginally diagnosed children are more likely to end up diagnosed and treated for ADHD in Sweden. So this tells us that somewhere in this long referral to diagnosis process, a marginal misdiagnosis of one child is used to tag or flag younger siblings as higher risk. So to think about the mechanism that generates this, we sort of need to think about all the entities that are involved in this process. And this process involves schools, it involves families, and it involves doctors. So we're gonna think about them one by one. So schools, as you know, they play a key role in referring children to psychiatrists for ADHD evaluation. And they also often have these direct economic incentives to identify ADHD in students. This means that schools may use a correct or indirect diagnosis of one student to flag younger siblings for referral. And while we do not directly observe referrals made at schools, we can examine this by exploiting the fact that the compensation that municipalities get for special needs children varies across municipalities. And we find that the misdiagnosis spillover is larger in municipalities where schools have stronger financial incentives to produce ADHD diagnosis or to identify ADHD in the children. So this suggests that schools may play an important role in perpetuating these spillovers across the family tree. Now, families may also play an important role. So one child's correct or incorrect diagnosis may raise the likelihood that a family asks for a screening for a sibling. So for example, the family already has an established existing connection to a child psychiatrist, so the hassle costs would be lower. But this would be observationally equivalent in the data to a channel that does not involve the family, namely that the treating psychiatrist may use the older sibling's diagnosis as a tag. So to distinguish the role of families, what we're going to do is to study spillover effects on younger cousins as well. So the idea here is that cousins are less likely to attend the same school, and they are less likely to see the same healthcare providers, but their parents, who themselves are siblings, may communicate about children's health issues. So that what you see in this graph. So again, we have the x-axis being the older sibling's month of birth, but we change the outcome variable to the share of younger cousins who consume ADHD drugs. And this figure presents graphical evidence of substantial spillovers to younger cousins as well. And the regression results here suggest that the spillover effect onto cousins is 32%, down here, is 32% of the effect of the younger cousin, him or herself, being oldest for grade. And we also find that these spillover effects are larger when cousins live in the same municipality. So this suggests that families play a distinct role on top of that played by schools or physicians, because of course, when cousins live in different municipalities, they are not in the same schools and they are very likely not seeing the same physicians. Now, finally, let's turn to the role of doctors. So suppose that schools and parents react to a misdiagnosis of an older child by taking various actions that raise the likelihood that this younger sibling gets a referral and ends up in the psychiatrist's office for an ADHD screening. Now, if the psychiatrist had access to a precise diagnosis technology, then she would be able to undo this entire referral gap between siblings of December born and siblings of January born kids. But precisely because the diagnosis process for ADHD is noisy, the doctor actually cannot just undo this referral gap. Okay, so she cannot just run a genetic test that comes out with a dummy variable, you know, yes, this person has ADHD, this person does not. Now, in addition to the fact that the noisy diagnosis process just makes it hard to undo this referral gap, the doctor may, of course, also directly use the older sibling's potential misdiagnosis in the diagnosis process. And we can investigate in the data, we can look at whether when diagnosing the younger sibling, doctors appear to take into account the month of birth of the older sibling, okay? Because that should contain information about how severe ADHD is in the older sibling. And we see in the data that doctors do not seem to take this into account at all. So this suggests that doctors do not use all the available relevant information when they diagnose the younger child. And it also suggests that the simple policy of just making physicians take the older sibling's month of birth into account, if that older sibling has ADHD, could mitigate potentially some of these spillovers. Now, in the final part of the paper, we try to explore the potential direct economic costs of these spillovers. And one way that we can do this in our data is to examine the effect of the older sibling's age for grade on younger siblings' educational and economic outcomes. So in this table, We study the younger siblings' high school GPA, college attainment, and earnings. And the estimates in the second row here show that younger siblings who themselves are born after the cutoff have a higher high school GPA, are more likely to be college enrolled, and have lower earnings. Okay? And this college enrollment effect explains this negative effect on own earnings measured in the same year. Now, all of these second row estimates are consistent with a pre-existing evidence, with a pre-existing literature of an effect of own relative age for grade on own human capital attainment. Now, the first row shows the spillover effect. And we do not find any statistically significant spillovers on educational attainment, but we do find that younger siblings whose older siblings are born after the cutoff have 3.3% higher earnings than younger siblings of children born before the cutoff. And here is the corresponding plot of the raw data on earnings in 2016. Now, one interpretation of this result is that there are no long-run benefits of long-run use of ADHD drugs. If anything, this result is consistent with there being a negative effect. But we should note that other interpretations are also possible here that involves other types of family dynamics. So for example, in recent work by Christoph Karbovnik and his co-authors, they propose a role model effect. So if the older sibling is oldest for grade and therefore does well in school, then the younger sibling may benefit from a positive education spillover. Now in our particular context, it's not clear that such a role model effect is applicable. We don't find any education spillovers, but of course we want to emphasize that we think of these results as pretty suggestive. So to summarize our key findings, so there is a substantial relative age-induced gap in diagnosis of ADHD in Sweden. And we find that this relative age-induced misdiagnosis propagate in the family tree to younger siblings as well as cousins. And then we find this economic cost, so younger siblings of children born before the cutoff have 3.3% lower earnings than younger siblings of children born after the cutoff. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Petra. Great paper. We've had a good number of questions. Let me lead with one from the attendees set. Seth Zimmerman asked, is it possible that the noise in the diagnosis process declines for the younger kids now that parents know more about what the drugs do? I sort of had a similar question of there's some learning that's going on and kind of how do you think about that in terms of they're seeing kind of real time or not real, they're learning about what their drugs actually do in practice. How does that fit in with the framework and the approach?
Yeah, so those are great questions. So I think one way that we can try to get at sort of this indirectly is to look at, we have older siblings born in December and born in January, and we have younger siblings born in December and born in January. And we believe, or under any of these mechanisms, the December-born kids will sort of have lighter versions of ADHD. And we can look in the data and see if we find any evidence consistent with this. So for example, we look at the how long do these kids stay on the drugs, conditional on starting them. And indeed, we find that December-born kids tend to actually get off them earlier than January-born kids, which is consistent with the idea that December-born kids have a lighter version of ADHD on average than January-born kids that are diagnosed. And to get to this question, so one thing that we can do is to look at whether that difference in the apparent severity of ADHD, whether that difference is smaller among younger siblings than among older siblings, so suggesting that sort of the error is smaller for younger siblings. And we don't really see any big differences in the gap in severity between December and January born kids when we look at older siblings and younger siblings. So that's one piece of evidence that would suggest that it doesn't seem to get much better for younger siblings. But I think that's so far the only thing that we've done in the data to try to get at this, to try to get at this directly. And the other thing I think to say about this is that when we think about how, so what are the mechanisms that make the misdiagnosis of the older sibling trickle down to the younger sibling, When we think about the role of the family, then these types of mechanisms might be important. So the family might be sort of raising the likelihood of the younger sibling being flagged, partly because they're already familiar with ADHD drugs. They're already sort of don't have as many reservations for going through an ADHD screening and so forth. So I think this learning might play a role in basically generating these spillovers within families.
Absolutely. Ziad had a question, unsurprisingly, perhaps given his paper on heterogeneity, and basically he's asking, have you looked by income, national origin, etc.? You know, essentially the question is if doctors are more inclined to write things off as ADHD in some particular populations of kids or families that you can look at there.
That's a great question. I actually thought of that myself when I listened to your talk. We haven't done as much about with that as we should. One thing that I didn't say, I guess with this time format, I took it off, but we only consider children who are born in Sweden or in the EU. So we actually don't have children born outside of the EU at all in our analysis. And the reason for that is that we discovered that we have a discontinuity in the share of children that are January born when we look in some groups of individuals that are born abroad. So basically we have a measurement error in the date of birth. So we only have children here born in Sweden or Europe. But we could definitely do this, for example, by socioeconomic status.